Welcome everyone to this next edition of our webinar series on optical coherence tomography. My name is Michael Leitner. I'm product and sales manager for OCT at 4Labs, and I will be the moderator for this live event. Today, my colleagues Sebastian Schäfer and Steve Jaeger will introduce us to the secrets of how to get the perfect OCT image and thereby share their year-long experience gained through imaging in numerous types of different samples under varying conditions. Dr. Sebastian Schäfer studied chemistry at the University of Siegen in Germany and graduated with a master's degree in 2008. After he obtained his doctorate in physical chemistry from the University of Hamburg in 2012, he was a postdoc researcher at the University of Rochester for 2 years. He joined 4Labs in 2015, where he currently leads a group of application engineers and supports 4Labs OCT customers with pre- and post-sales needs. Steve Jaeger studied physics at the University of Rostock in Germany and received his master's degree in 2015. His master's thesis focused on experimental quantum optics and the creation of non-classical light fields. Steve began his career as a development engineer in Hamburg and joined 4Labs in 2017, where he is now part of the OCT development team, focusing primarily on OEM. Please note that questions can be posted throughout the whole course of the webinar in the Q&A section, which you can access through the icon on the top right of your screen. Well, with that being said, I would like to hand over the stage to you, Sebastian and Steve.
Thank you for the introduction, Michael. And before I start with a general overview, I want to talk about the motivation for this talk. In my daily work, I see that our OCT systems are used by experienced researchers, but also by beginners that are just getting started. And this talk is supposed to help with getting started with OCT. And there are many settings in an OCT system that will affect the quality of an OCT image. On top of that, artifacts can give false impressions of the structure of the sample. So overall, it is important to know about these settings and artifacts in order to get a good OCT image. And I will just show you two examples of the same sample. So first, I will start with an OCT image of a roll of scotch tape. On the left side over here, you can see the OCT image, and it's really hard to distinguish the individual layers of the scotch tape that are stacked on top of each other. And on top of that, you see this dark band in the middle of the OCT image. And if I now change the settings of this OCT system, I get the image on the right side, where I do not have the dark band in the middle and where I can clearly see the individual layers of the tape. So just changing the settings of an OCT system can improve the OCT image quality dramatically. And the idea here is it is easy to get an OCT image, but it is much harder to get a good OCT image. With that, I want to come to my overview. So I just talked about the motivation for this talk, and after this overview, I will briefly talk about the impact of the OCT specifications and then mostly focus on finding the best settings. After that, Steve will talk about artifacts in OCT image, where do they come from, and what to do about the artifacts. And please note that this talk is just about best practice, but there's no one size fits all solution. That means you still have to know a bit about your sample and you have to play with the settings a little bit to find what is best for your experiment or for your sample. Throughout this talk, we will show some videos and some OCT images, and Steve and I will sometimes use this red cap. This is a plastic sample that is about 1 millimeter thick, and you will see that in a couple of videos. With that, I want to start with the selection of the OCT wavelength. So OCT typically operates in the near-infrared wavelength regime, and here we typically talk about 800 to 1500 nanometers. And once you buy or set up an OCT system, the wavelength is typically fixed. And now let me show you two OCT images and how the wavelength impacts the OCT image. So here you can see two OCT images of my fingertip. So this is skin. And on the left side, you see an OCT image acquired at 900 nanometers and on the right side at 1300 nanometers. And you can see a clear difference between the two images. At 900 nanometers, you get a much better axial and lateral resolution, so the image appears crisper. And on the right side, at 1300 nanometers, you get a better penetration into the sample. So your penetration depth is deeper, and you can actually see some structures of the dermis down here that you cannot see at 900 nanometers. So in this case, it depends on what you are interested in. Are you interested in high resolution images of the top layer, the epidermis, then you would choose 900 nanometers, or are you interested in imaging deeper layers like the dermis, then you would pick a 1300 nanometer system. And this will be different depending on your sample. So it is very important that you check which wavelength works for your sample, because the penetration also depends on the wavelength. And then the other selection that I want to talk about today is the selection of sample optics. And here you can see four OCT images with four different objectives: 10x objective, 5x, 3x, and 1.6x. And the sample in all of these images is the same. It's iron oxide nanoparticles. These nanoparticles are a bit under a micron in diameter. And what you can see here is, because these iron oxide nanoparticles are smaller than our axial or lateral resolution, you can actually image our resolution with this sample. So what you can see here on the left side is that the focus sits around here, and just a little bit above and below the focus, you can see that the image gets very blurry. And you can also see that these individual dots that you see in here, they are more elliptical and elongated along the depth axis. And now if we move to the right to lower magnifications, this shape is more round and eventually more elongated in the lateral dimension. This is because the resolution changes from the left to the right side, and we have the better or higher lateral resolution on the left side and the lower resolution on the right side. And over here, you can see that for these two lenses, it's much easier to get a good image still above and below the focus position. We can also visualize this in this graph, where you see the 10x lens in red, and you see in focus you have the most. So this is the depth, this is the intensity. You have the highest intensity in focus, but as soon as you're out of focus, the intensity drops quite dramatically. Whereas for other lenses, low magnifications, you have a larger depth of focus, and you can still get some sample light back when you're a little bit out of focus. So in choosing the sample optics, you have a trade-off between the lateral resolution and the depth of focus. If you want a high lateral resolution, then your depth of focus will be quite low, or the other way around. But the advantage over the selection of the wavelength is that you can actually change the sample optics in between experiments, and thereby you can choose the sample optics depending on what you need in a certain application or experiment. There are other parameters I could talk about, but I will now focus on the settings. Before I do that, I want to mention though that there's also the question whether you choose a swept source or a spectral domain OCT system. And We had a webinar on this topic earlier this year that you can find on our website at thoughtlabs.com/webinars. Okay, so let's talk about the focus and reference arm. Here you can see the basic setup of an OCT system. We have a light source. The light goes into a beam splitter, is split up into a reference arm and into a sample arm, is reflected or scattered back, combined again at the beam splitter, and then sent to a detector where we get our interference pattern that we then analyze. And you can imagine it's an interferometric method, so both sample and reference arm have to match in length. This will give us a signal, but not necessarily good image, because in the sample arm, you also have focusing optics. So on top of matching reference and sample arm, you also have to make sure that your sample is in focus. And let me show you how this looks like by adjusting focus and reference arm for an OCT system that is not set up well. So here we have a video of the sample. This is the red cap that I mentioned before. It's out of focus. You can see the image is a little bit blurry. This is our OCT image. I now change the dynamic range so you can actually see the noise. So we can now see the noise. I change the focus. And what you will see now is once I am in focus, you will see at the top, we see some autocorrelation. This is an artifact that Steve will talk about later in the talk. And now I change the reference arm length because I know I'm in focus. And changing the reference arm length, and now I can see the image move in and it stays in focus. Now I do some fine adjustments and we found our OCT image. You can now change the dynamic range again, and then we have our first OCT image for the day. Now let's talk about what happens if we have a reflective medium in the sample arm. So you can imagine we might have some glass or water in the sample arm. How does that affect our OCT image? So let's watch another video. So we start at the same sample, same position where we left off. I have some water in this red cap that I will fill in. I have to move the red cap underneath the probe a little bit. So now we're at a slightly different position. And now I fill in the water and watch what happens. Our image moves down. And now we can see the line right here. This is the red cap, but it's not a good image. So let's do the whole process again. I change the focus. I find autocorrelation at the top. And I change the reference arm length again. And here we are, we have an OCT image again. So now the question is, what happened? Why do we have to adjust the focus and reference arm again after introducing a reflective medium into the sample arm? So let's look at it. This is our sample optics in air. So let's just assume this is our focus and this is where the focus is. Just a simple sketch. And now we introduce reflective medium into the sample arm. And at the interface air, reflective medium, in our case water interface, we have refraction. So the image or the focus is actually shifted down now. This means our focus is now longer. The focus shifts down. But on top of that, I mentioned that OCT is an interferometric method. So since the light is now slowed down in the reflective medium, we have to compensate for that too, because the light in the reference arm is not slowed down. So we're looking at the optical path length in this image, and we see that for these two reasons, we also have to change the reference arm length. In particular, we have to make it longer. So you can overall, you have to adjust the focus and reference arm length after you introduce a refractive medium into the sample arm. Now, on top of that, let's also talk about dispersion, which is a blurred signal in depth. So same sample as before, and we just start where we left off. And in our software, in our ThoraImage software, we go to dispersion compensation. And now we change the slider and we look at the axial shape of this interface. And we see if we change the dispersion compensation in our software, it gets more narrow. And then if we move the slider too far to the left and overcompensate it, it gets broader again. So we found the best setting around negative 50 in this case. So this is where it's rather narrow. And now let's turn it off again. The dispersion compensation, it's now off and you can see it's broader. Let's turn it back on again. It's more narrow. Just one more time, off and on. So you see the difference. And this is just because of dispersion that was introduced by the water. So what exactly is dispersion? Dispersion means that the refractive index depends on the wavelength. And what now happens is we have a broad spectrum. And since the refractive index is not the same at every wavelength, you essentially get some light that travels faster than other light of the spectrum. And this just leads to a signal broadening in depth because of the slight time mismatch. This typically happens when you introduce water or glass or plastic into the sample arm. And you can, of course, introduce the same medium into the reference arm, but this is often not feasible. So it can also be adjusted in our ThoraImage OCT software. And here you can see two images again, where you see the original image over here and then the adjusted image over here, and a much crisper interface and signal in general. Okay, now I want to talk about the signal roll-off. Signal roll-off is a drop in sensitivity with increased depth. And this is more prominent in spectral domain OCT technology. I will show you a video for this too, but before I start the video, let me just mention a few things that we should look out for. So here you can see this red plastic cap that I showed you earlier, and we can see the top and bottom interface of this red plastic cap. And over here you see a yellow line going down, and this is an A scan. So that is a depth scan along this yellow line. And we can see the top interface and bottom interface here. And what we will look out for in the video is the top interface, and especially the signal intensity of the top interface. And I will move the whole image down. So we start here at a bit over 90 dB, and now we move it down. And what we see is that the intensity decreases. And once we are quite down, it's actually below 90 dB now. We're at about 85. And if we move it back up, then the intensity goes up again. And we can also look at the bottom signal over here, which is at 60 dB right now. And now if we move the image up, it flips at the top, comes back down. And now what basically the bottom interface sits at around 70 dB. So we have a higher sensitivity at the top. And I just flipped the image in our software. And now this helps us to now get a higher sensitivity at the bottom of the image. So you can imagine that sometimes you're not interested just in the top of your sample, but in structures that are deeper, you can actually flip the image at the top and then have the region that you're actually interested in the top of your OCT image. And there our OCT system is more sensitive and you get a high signal intensity. Now I want to talk a little bit about averaging. Here you can see an image of my fingernail over here and some skin. And this is without averaging. Again, over here you see an A scan along the yellow line. And I will now show you another image that is with A scan averaging, and you can look out for the how the A scan changes. So this is with A scan averaging. A scan averaging basically means that we acquire one depth scan and then another one at the same position and potentially even more at the same position before we move to the next position, and we average these A scans to get our B scan image. And you can already see that I go back again, the A scan is less noisy and you can clearly see deeper structures if you do some averaging. Now you can also imagine that we can do B scan averaging. B scan averaging means we acquire a whole frame or B scan and then another one and then another one, and then we average those. And you see that when you compare these two, the signal actually does look different. Here with A scan averaging, you have higher noise on your signal, but your noise floor is lower. Whereas with B scan averaging, your noise floor is higher, but there's also less noise on your signal. Okay, so this is, you can see that here again. Now we'll show you a video. And in this video, I will again look at this red plastic cap that I mentioned earlier. And I will just hit the table, and what you will see is that the sample will move a little bit. And we will look at how that influence is influenced by A scan or B scan averaging. So let's start just without any averaging. And you see that the sample is just moving up and down a little bit whenever I hit the table. Now let's do A scan averaging. So A scan averaging, of course, slows down the measurement because we spend more time at every position, and you can see that not the whole image changes, but just a small part. And if we do B scan averaging, and if I now hit the table, then you can see that basically several images overlay. So in the end, that means you have to think about, especially for samples that move, you have to think about if you want to do averaging and if A scan or B scan averaging is better. And especially if you have a sample that moves, of course, A scan averaging would be better choice than B scan averaging. Now let's talk about gain setting. Gain setting is an electronic amplification of the signal, but what you have to keep in mind that it may also amplify artifacts. So in the end, you have to find a balance between a good gain and the reference intensity. For Thorlabs OCT systems, this only applies to swept source OCT systems, that is the Vega and HR series. And now I will show you a video again of my fingernail, and I will start with the lowest gain setting and then slowly move to higher gain settings. So you can see this is the penetration depth with the lowest gain setting. If I increase the gain setting, you can actually image deeper into the sample, in this case into my fingernail. So this is where it was before. But at some point, if you have a gain that is too high, you just get artifacts. So you have to find a good balance. So in this case, a good balance is with amplification 4 or 5. That gives a pretty good image. You can change the dynamic range a little bit to get a nice OCT image. Oh, let's talk about A scan rate adjustment. In this case, the integration time on the spectrometer is adjusted. So I start with 76 kilohertz in this case, and I will increase this now to 28 kilohertz, which means decrease to 28 kilohertz, which means higher integration time. But that also means too much light on the detector, so we have too much light, so we have to adjust the reference light in this case to then get the image. And you can see that you can actually image deeper into the sample now with the lower A scan rate. I will show you the OCT images at 76 and 28 kilohertz in a second, and we can compare them next to each other. But what's important here is that a lower A-scan rate increases the sensitivity, but it slows down the measurement. And for Thorlabs OCT systems, this only applies to spectral domain OCT systems. That is the Ganymede and Telesto series. Now let's compare the two images that I just mentioned. The top, you can see an image acquired at 76 kilohertz or high A-scan rate, and at the bottom 28 kilohertz, which is a lower A-scan rate. And what you can see is that at a high A-scan rate, you have less penetration into the sample and a lower sensitivity compared to a lower A-scan rate. But of course, one of the advantages is that you can image faster. So for dynamic processes, this might be crucial. And you also have less autocorrelation. This is the artifact I mentioned earlier. This is at the top of the image. You can see that you have a lot more over here compared to the higher A-scan rate over here. And the last point I want to talk about today is the reference intensity. So the reference light is used to generate an interference pattern. Let's look at another video again. So I just start with a good OCT image, and then I will decrease the reference intensity, and I will see that the intensity of the OCT image will actually decrease, and at some point there's almost no OCT image left. Basically, I can just see the surface. So let's increase the reference intensity again to a good level. You can actually see it in our software. Green is good level. And we can also go the other direction. We can go to more reference light. And too much reference light is not good for the OCT image. You can see here that you get some artifacts in the OCT image. So let's go back to the good setting. Okay, so this is a good OCT image where we have the right amount of reference light. Okay, so a low reference light intensity leads to a low signal. Then you can add more reference light, and that can actually be boosted to can actually be used to boost an even weak sample light. So just a little bit of sample light can be boosted by a lot of reference light, but you should not add too much reference light because that will lead to artifacts. And this is what Steve will talk about now.
Okay, thank you, Sebastian. As Sebastian already mentioned, depending on the sample and the setup's condition, sometimes we have to deal with unwanted artifacts in OCT images. In the following part of the talk, I want to address the most common ones and how we can handle them. Just as a note at the start of my part, despite the title of the talk, the images will present today are not quote-unquote perfect OCT images. Instead, they are intended to highlight the artifact we discussed in the best possible way. Okay, let's hop into the first topic and continue the thought Sebastian stated lastly about the intensity adjustment. If you receive too much light from the sample and reference arm, you will saturate the OCT detector. Saturation artifacts will occur in the OCT images, and the first clue for that would be vertical lines of individually oversaturated A scans, which can be seen here in this part of the OCT image. They are quite disturbing, and you can easily imagine how they could ruin your measurement. The next obvious sign are high harmonic signals, which start suddenly to appear. They are indicated here. And if you change the reference position gradually, you will recognize that they will move multiple times faster than the main signal, which results from the fact that those signals have multiple times the signal frequency. In the following small recording, I will try to demonstrate this movement. Here you see how I increase the reference intensity into the oversaturated state. The indication turns red, and vertical lines starts to appear in this area of the OCT image. as well as higher harmonics below the main signal. Afterwards, I moved the reference arm of the probe gradually back and forth. And if you try to keep an eye on the higher harmonic signals, you see the difference in their velocity. The source of those saturation artifacts is the nonlinear response of the camera and photodiodes used in OCT instruments. The sample signal gets broadened at the maxima, and because of the Fourier transformation in the signal processing, the A-scan signal afterwards consists of multiples of the original signal frequency. As a reminder, for example, the Fourier transformation of a rectangular function consists of all frequencies, which is the extreme case. The last possibility to easily identify an oversaturation we provide with our Thor image software. If the reference light oversaturates the detector, we indicate this failed state by the color bar we show here. A red indication corresponds to an oversaturation of the reference intensity. You can expect saturation artifacts when the indication is highlighted in red. Okay, now let's come to the topic on how we can cope with this type of artifact. The first possibility would be to start and to do adjustments in the sample arm. If it is feasible for you, you could simply tilt the sample relative to the A-scan axis, which is illustrated here on the right. Doing that would lower the intensity of backscattered light from the first sample surface drastically. Another possibility would be to adjust the focus position slightly, away from having the focus on the first surface, but rather placing it, for example, in the sample itself. The last adjustment in the sample arm we can easily do in order to handle oversaturation is to introduce a wedge with a suitable immersion medium above the sample. If your application allows it, this would also lower the reflection from the main sample surface. A pretty simple way to decrease the signal modulation is to lower the intensity of the reference arm. For low sample intensities, the reference arm intensity adjustment can be used to boost the modulation. On the contrary, when having high reflective samples, the adjustment can be used to decrease the modulation to a usable and not oversaturated level. A system setting which can be used to handle oversaturation is to increase the A-scan rate. For example, if you place a bucket under an apple tree for just 1 or 2 hours, a lesser amount of apples will fall into it compared to the case of placing it for 1 day under the tree. The same holds for the number of photons on the detector. A higher A-scan rate results in a smaller measured intensity. Okay, the last possibility not oversaturate the detector would be to adjust the gain settings. Sebastian mentioned the gain settings already in his first part of our webinar today. The gain level can be accessed in the displayed systems here on the right, and a lower gain level corresponds to a lower overall modulation of the OCT signal. This wraps up the saturation artifacts. In the following part of my talk, I would like to discuss auto and cross correlations. For visualization purposes, here on the right side of the slide, I placed the simplified schematic of a typical OCT setup. Sebastian showed this image earlier in his part as well. The sample and reference arm is shown, and an arbitrary photo detector measures the superimposed light fields. The signals which are detected with such a technique are firstly the main signal itself, which comes from a superposition of the reference and the sample light. Secondly, the conjugated signal where the role of the reference and sample arm is changed is measured as well. An inference signal from only the sample or only the reference is called autocorrelation. The latter one is oftentimes called the DC term and will not be discussed further in this talk. Now let's have a look at specifically the autocorrelation signals. They can be identified by appearing as a slightly altered copy of the sample at the top of the image, like you can see here. This artifact is stationary, and by changing the reference position, the main signal will shift in the depth, but the autocorrelation signal stays where it is. In this example, we look here at a two-layered foil, which I tilted slightly. The main signal appears here in this area of the OCT image and the autocorrelation signal at the top as discussed. Due to the fact that in the case of the autocorrelation signal, the reference position, the reference point is the first surface of the foil, the tilt will not be longer detected. As distracting as this artifact may seem to you right now, it can contain some valuable information about the sample. For example, with a proper setup, we could easily determine this foil thickness from the autocorrelation signal. The message here is now the following. Artifacts are not always annoying, but sometimes can carry information we can use to our advantage. A different way to identify an autocorrelation signal is by closing the reference arm. After we block it, the stationary artifact will remain in the OCT image. Which I want to demonstrate in this small video here. Again, you see the two-layered foil signal and the autocorrelation signal at the top. Here now, I block the reference light and you see the main signal disappearing, but the artifact remaining. The interpretation is clear. The superimposed signals have to come from the sample arm itself. Okay, now, if you do not want to seize the additional information from the autocorrelation signal, how can you avoid or omit those signals? First, we can simply change the A-scan rate. This would decrease the overall intensity of the superimposed sample signals. We can also change the focus position away from the first sample surface. You could, for example, again, place the focus position into the sample itself. Tilting the sample would be another possibility. This would again lower the back reflected amount of light coming from the main surface. Generally speaking, we would like to encourage you to carefully prepare the sample arm. Please avoid unnecessary reflections. These can already occur when the sample is not mounted in a proper way. If you have a transparent sample and you have a highly reflective surface below your sample, autocorrelation definitely will occur. If you cannot mount the sample in a different way, you have the possibility to choose this gap here big enough that the resulting signal is not within the measurement window. If you don't use the scan lenses recommended by us, but rather develop your own probe, it would be good to keep in mind to design the anti-reflection coatings appropriately. Unwanted internal reflections inside the scan optics can cause autocorrelations as well. If you cannot lower the reflection from the first sample surface by design, you are able to handle that issue by introducing again a wedge or a window into the sample arm. Together with a suitable immersion fluid, this would lower the light reflected from the first surface again. Okay, yes, our Thor image software offers another possibility to cope with this type of artifact. We implemented an autocorrelation filter into the software in order to cancel out those signals. Like every algorithm, which should cover a broad band of applications, depending on the sample, the filter effect may differ. One example of this filter function I want to show here. In this case, I imaged a multi-layered foil and the autocorrelation artifact can again be found at the top. After applying the filter, the OCT image looks as follows. The overall intensity of the autocorrelation artifacts is decreased in this example significantly. And you can apply the filter by clicking in the small box named autocorrelation compensation to the right of the OCT image. Earlier, I mentioned different types of signals appearing in OCT images. The main signal, the conjugated main signal, and autocorrelation signals. The main signal itself can now contain an interference portion of another artifact. This artifact is called cross-correlation and it results from unwanted multiple internal reflections in the sample arm or in the reference arm. A simplified example is shown here. Besides the superimposed signals from the reflection of the first and the second surface, sample surface and the reference, multiple internally reflected light fields interfere as well with the reference light. An easy way to identify them is to block the reference light and see if the artifact disappears together with the main signal. Because some unwanted additional path length is introduced in the sample arm, some kind of copy of the sample can be found below the sample signals. The distance of those two signals is directly linked to the unwanted additional optical path length. Furthermore, it will move with the same velocity as the main signal itself when we change the reference stage position. Let's have a look at the former example, the two-layered foil. Again, you see the tape and the autocorrelation signal at the top, but if we take a closer look below the main structures, we recognize an additional weak signal which can be found here in this part of the OCT image. This is a cross-correlation artifact resulting from the tape itself. You see, if I change the reference position, this artifact is following the main signal with the same velocity, and it appears in the same distance from the sample as the width of the structures inside the sample itself. Therefore, this cross-correlation signal is the interferometric signal from the internal reflection at the last and the first surface. And if we close the reference intensity, I will do it right here, I think. Yeah. The signal disappears together with the sampled signal. Okay. The handling of this type of artifact is basically the same as we discussed earlier for the autocorrelation. Therefore, I will not repeat those points. I would rather like to come to another artifact which is difficult to handle. It is called multi-scattering, also referred as crosstalk. Let's have a look at this simple example here. We now take a look at a tilted sheet of paper on a glass substrate. Imaging it under an OCT results in the image shown here on the right. On the left side, we see the glass substrate, and on the right side, we see a feature which seems quite thick. But we have the advantage to know that we placed just a 150 micrometer thick paper on the glass substrate. The sample cannot be as bulky as the OCT image lets us think here. Furthermore, we do not see a second surface of the sheet of paper itself, as well as no glass substrate below it. You have to know OCT for itself is quite dumb. It visualizes the relatively traveled path length of photons. In this case here, now here's the clue, paper is quite the intense scatterer. Multiple scattered photons travel a longer path length than the not scattered ones. For this reason, signals from multiple scattered photons appear to be deeper in the image than physically true. Now you may ask yourself the question, how can I identify this kind of artifact? Now this is the difficult part, because the only diagnostic we can do is to recognize deviations from the sample shape we would expect. Unfortunately, we have to cope with this kind of artifact. A careful interpretation of the OCT images is necessary when we deal with highly scattering samples. Therefore, oftentimes some knowledge about the sample is needed. One thing you can try to do is to change the operation wavelength. For example, instead of using a light source at 930 nanometer, you could try to use a 1300 nanometer source. The scattering effect can be less critical at a different wavelength. Okay, we now have covered the highly scattering samples and the corresponding image distortions, but oftentimes the refractive index itself already has an influence on the OCT image. I would like you to have a look at the schematic setup I show here. In this example, we will image a scattering plastic, and on the left side of the imaged area, the photons will have to travel through a piece of transparent plastic. The resulting OCT image is shown here on the right. We can clearly notice a height shift below the transparent plastic piece. Furthermore, the imaging range in this area here seems to be decreased by the transparent plastic. The structures which could appear in this depth here, we wouldn't be able to image in this part of the OCT image. This, of course, is just the case when the transparent plastic is still within the imaging window. Otherwise, it's just a height shift, which can be compensated by the reference position. Well, to sum this up, the giveaway for this type of artifact would be a visible height shift and consequently a reduction in the imaging depth if the additional medium is within the imaging window. The reason for that I mentioned earlier, OCT images visualize differences in the travel time between photons which propagate in the reference and sample arm. This, of course, includes the group refraction index of the imaged media. As we know in media, the velocity of electromagnetic fields is lowered by the group refraction index. As a consequence, the travel speed of those photons is decelerated. Thereby, structures appear to be deeper in the OCT image when passing through a refractive medium than they truly are. To now conclude my thought, the height shift in OCT image in the OCT image can be explained by the deceleration of photons in the transparent plastic. Furthermore, the image transparent plastic appears thicker as well in the OCT image than physically true, which as well can be explained by the influence of the refractive index. From this example here on the top, it's now evident that with imaging through a window or wedge, a shift in the imaging depth comes along. We have to keep in mind this effect when we use a window or wedge during the imaging. Unfortunately, again, here as well, there is no proper way to deal with this kind of artifact. A careful interpretation of the OCT images is necessary when we image through additional optical mediums. Yes, okay. The interpretation will be even more difficult when the imaged surfaces are not horizontal. Here, another type of distortion can occur, which is caused by refraction. Effects like shadowing can happen, refraction at interfaces, or multiple measured structures as well. I would like to explain those effects on the example of a strongly tilted wedge I show here at the bottom. On the left side, you see the geometric representation of the wedge, and on the right, the corresponding OCT image. Below the wedge, a highly reflective surface can be found, drawn here in red. This reflective surface can be seen in the OCT representation as well, again in red. Firstly, due to the refractive index of the wedge, we see an increased optical path length in the OCT representation. In the chamfered region, between the region A and B, the interesting part happens now. The diffracted light travels at an angle through the sample, which corresponds to an increased travel distance, which can be seen especially in this area here. In OCT, paths are displayed vertically in one dimension, but we now would like to measure three-dimensional structures, and light can reach the detector from off-axis. Again, distortions can appear from that. Okay, and the biggest challenges now are the following. There can be errors on the sample, which can be seen, for example, here below A, which cannot be imaged. And the bad thing is, there's no indication for that in the corresponding OCT image. Furthermore, there can be structures which are measured twice. This region here on the right is a good example for that. This area is measured twice, firstly by the photons which are passing perpendicular through the sample, and secondly by the angled propagation at the point B. All right, I think I will end my thoughts on this artifact with that. And in direct comparison to the former artifacts, the last one I will mention today, again, can be handled quite well. It's commonly referred as aliasing or undersampling, and it occurs mainly in spectral domain OCT. If we position the sample signals close to the largest possible measurement depth, the artifact starts to appear. It can be seen here as vertical lines in this area of the OCT image. The obvious suggestion to avoid this artifact is to place the sample structures near the top of the image. That way, we simply do not reach the region where this kind of artifact appears. If it's not feasible for you, again, we provide in our Thor image software a filter which handles undersampling artifacts quite well. Applied, the OCT image looks as shown here on the right. In this example, the vertical lines are completely cancelled out by the filter. And in our software, it can be applied directly over the checkbox of the autocorrelation compensation. The source of those artifacts is the measurement and processing procedure itself. By placing the signal at the bottom of the image, we approach the highest possible frequency, which can be measured, defined by the Nyquist theorem. Signals which have a higher frequency than this limit gets undersampled. Those undersampled signals fold back into the measurement window, appearing as artifacts. The undersampling filter is designed to correct those signals. If you would like to rather not correct your OCT images by any filter, I would like to present a different approach to handle undersampling. In our software, we have the possibility to flip the image horizontally. Sebastian used this feature earlier in his part as well. Here, I have an arbitrary sample which spans a big amount of the imaging depth. If I drive the sample to the bottom of the measurement window to the highest possible measurable frequency, undersampling artifacts appear. You see them here. Then you see how I try to highlight the emerging of the vertical lines. And afterwards, you see me applying the undersampling filter. But instead of leaving it like that, you see me driving the sample back into the initial position and then flip the image. Yeah, right here. Afterwards, I change the reference position in a way that the signal moves to lower measurement depth out of the imaging window. In OCT, signals get folded back into the measurement window. The image can be placed now at the former top, which is currently the bottom of the image. And due to the fact that we are actually at the top of the image, thus far from the highest measurable frequency, no undersampling artifacts appear. All right, to wrap up Sebastian and my talk, I will give just a small summary about the topics we cover today. First, we talked about the impact of the OCT specifications on the OCT images. Afterwards, we covered finding the best possible settings by adjusting the reference and focus position. We talked about the impact of averaging and the A-scan rate, the gain, and the reference intensity adjustment on the image quality. During my part of the talk, we spoke about how to improve and understand different kinds of artifacts. We discussed how an oversaturation generates saturation artifacts, and we spoke about autocorrelation and cross-correlation artifacts and how to distinguish them from each other. We covered the issue of multi-scattering on the really simple example of a sheet of paper. We discussed the influence of the refractive index and other distortions by refraction in OCT images. And in the final stage of this webinar, we gone over the diagnostic and the handling of undersampling artifacts. All right, I hope we are able to give you a good starting point to tackle unwanted artifacts and a good overview on how to prepare your setup in a way that you will get a satisfying OCT picture in the future. With that statement, I would now like to transfer the mic back to Michael.
Thank you very much, Sebastian and Steve, for these really interesting insights. And we already have several questions from the audience, and the first one comes from Sarah. Does changing the imaging medium, like, for example, submerging the sample in water, change the depth resolution of the OCT image?
Okay, let me take that question. I think the short answer is no, but the longer answer is in water, you do get a better resolution, but your sample does have a different refractive index than water. It has its own refractive index. So let's say you are imaging tissue and image tissue just in air or submerge it in water, then your tissue still has a refractive index of about 1.4. And in both cases, you get the same resolution for your tissue sample, which will be the resolution of the OCT system divided by, in this case, 1.4. Michael?
Oh, sorry, I was muted. The next question comes from Chris. Very nice images, thank you. How is gain adjusted? Electronic gain or reference arm power or something else?
I think I can answer that. We have an electronical gain adjustment. After we're getting the balance detection signal, we have several amplification levels, and we can with our software we can adjust those, and it's just a amplification of those electronical signals. I hope this answered your question.
The next question comes from Leslie. Which was the system used to acquire the B scans showed in the videos, and how long does it take to acquire one single B scan?
Okay, I can take this one. We actually use different systems for the images, but especially the red cap that I used for a lot of my videos, that was acquired using a Telesta system. So that is a spectral domain OCT system at 1300 nanometers. And a typical time to acquire a B scan. So we do get a video frame rate with OCT, and a typical time is maybe on the order of 10 milliseconds. But this in the end depends on, do you do some averaging? Do you choose a lower A scan rate just to get a larger or better sensitivity? And also the question, how many A scans do you put in a B scan? Because at least for our software, you can choose anywhere upwards of 100 A scans per B scan to thousands, even more than 10,000 are possible. And of course, if you put a lot of A scans in one B scan, then the time will go up. But typical times are 10 milliseconds.
Thank you. The next question, how to improve the posterior surface of the sample? Can you please explain the flipping image example?
Okay, flipping the image. So the idea here is that the spectral domain OCT system is more sensitive when your sample is at the top, or if you just look at your image, it's more sensitive in the top third, top half, compared to the bottom. And now if you are interested in the posterior surface of your sample, then you can flip the image at the top. And flipping the image at the top is basically, you can view it as the OCT system just analyzes an interference pattern. It just looks at the interference pattern. And this interference pattern is generated by comparing the travel times of the photons in the sample arm and the travel times of the photons in the reference arm. And you just compare them. You compare them, how much longer did it take the one photon compared to the other photon? And our OCT system does not know which path the individual photons took. So it cannot distinguish, is the sample arm longer than the reference arm, or is the reference arm longer than the sample arm? And that's the reason why the image flips at the top. Basically, that if your sample arm is typically a little bit longer than your reference arm, but if you make it a little bit shorter than your reference arm, then the image flips at the top and our OCT system our OCT system views that as a flip because it doesn't know that now the sample arm is shorter. And we can use that to our advantage to then bring parts of the sample, in this case, the posterior surface, to the top of the image and get the higher sensitivity benefits. I hope this answered the question.
Okay, the next one comes from Jon Teich. I'm working on biofilm and I found that the automated adjustment of dynamic range gave different image results even though I imaged the same sample.
Yeah, I can imagine that some fluctuations caused our software to have several different outcomes. But if you have an issue with that, you can just hover over the dynamic range adjustment, see where your initial thresholds are at the moment, and remember that. And for your next measurement, just change the dynamic range manually and adjust it that way. So, Sebastian, do we have something to add?
Yeah, I would maybe add that basically we have an algorithm that looks at the histogram of the intensity in your whole image. And now if your sample is different, you get a different histogram and that might influence the adjustment of the dynamic range. So if you always want the same, then you should just do what Steve just mentioned to adjust it manually.
Okay, the next question. Any suggestions on noise reduction from B-scans except for B-scan averaging?
So when you are using a swept source OCT, so our swept source OCT, just say a WEGA or a HREA system, you can lower the gain settings. This would decrease the overall noise level. If this is feasible, you can do that.
I think overall it's probably I think there's, in this case, we have the answer. There's no one size fits all, what I mentioned earlier. If you want to discuss your noise issues in detail, then you can reach out to us and we can maybe discuss it in more detail.
Okay, thank you. So we are already well over time, and so many thanks to everybody for attending our webinar today. If you have any ideas for OCT-related topics that you would like to see discussed, please drop us a message at oct@4labs.com. And the next general 4Labs webinar is scheduled for December 1st, when Manfred Gonnard will explain light polarization. I'm looking forward to seeing you again during our future events and wish you a nice day. Thank you.